Yeah, welcome back to The Breakfast on Plus TV Africa. And we're talking about the big stories that we've seen on major newspapers in Nigeria today. And it's the Judiciary Staff Union of Nigeria, JUSUN. They have locked out staff members, lawyers, litigants, and the general public. And that's from the Federal High Court Complex in Maitama, Abuja, as well as all high and magistrate courts in Lagos. The union members had used a padlock, you know, to prevent entry into the court premises. And they're basically saying that the federal government or President Muhammadu Buhari actually on May 22nd, 2020, signed into law an executive order to basically, you know, grant financial autonomy to, you know, the judiciary. And they're saying the federal government has not implemented this. They need the implementation of, you know, financial autonomy for the judiciary. And until that is done, they will continue to strike and deny access to the courts to any member of the public. And we've invited a legal practitioner, Mr. Monday Obani, to help us discuss this. Good morning, Mr. Obani.
Yeah, my pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Yes. First of all, they had been threatening to strike for a while now. You know, they even gave an ultimatum. According to them, you know, negotiations were not reached. The government did not attempt to, you know, communicate with them on this particular issue. So they decided to go on strike, locked, you know, high courts in Lagos and Abuja. Really, did you see this coming? Being that, you know, you're former vice president of the Nigerian Bar Association, regarding what's happening in the judiciary today.
Yeah, thank you once again. I have spoken so much about issue of independence of the judiciary. When the president signed the executive order granting this financial autonomy to the judiciary and even to the parliamentarians, I was one of those that went to town praising, commending, and telling the entire world that the president has done the right thing, and that is the right thing to do. Why? Because the Constitution itself has already made elaborate provision on the independence of these other two arms of government. Even though there were people who were arguing at that time that it is the president is just erring on the side of surplusage. As a constitutional provision, I agree that is a constitutional provision. But how many governors and how many of the states have implemented full autonomy for the judiciary? So I felt that the right thing that the president did should be commended, and that there is no room for prevarication. Well, I made it very clear, especially when the governors started running up and down, went to Aso Rock and started persuading the president now to lie low with the executive order. I raised an alarm at that point and said the president should not in any way back take a step backwards on this issue. He should insist on the full implementation of that executive order. If you remember vividly, that part of the provision is that there will be a first line charge every month on the allocation of the states on this issue of full autonomy, so that even if state government is in breach, the instruction was for the accountant general to take away the money that belonged to the other arms of government automatically without recourse to them. And I said that is the only way this will really be implemented. But I'm surprised that the president started prevaricating and started, you know, taking steps that are clearly dangerous and will impede on the independence of the judiciary. And so I'm not surprised that these people have waited, believing that the president they trusted, you know, should have insisted on the implementation of his executive order. But since he himself is playing a double standard on the entire thing, they now gave a strike warning, and nobody engaged them. And then we of course, you know what Osinbajo will say, we are where we are today as a result of the fact that the government itself is not serious about granting judicial autonomy.
Well, I want to go to the state government angle. If you remember also, not long ago, a couple of years ago, the Nigerian government also gave directives from the NFIU, I believe, with regards allocations to local governments. There's also been conversations about that, saying that state governments have refused to, you know, get the full implementation of that going. So why do you think state governors in Nigeria have struggled with implementing the executive order given by President Muhammadu Buhari with regards to financial autonomy for the judiciary?
We're good at enacting laws without the political will for implementation. The governors know this, you know, and they always hold the federal government to ransom. And when you have a government that is clearly weak, you know, not ready to implement their laws, that is where when you get things like this. Now, why would a government that swore to uphold the provisions of the constitution disobey the law of the land? I mean, why would it happen? And then why would those who are supposed to enforce the law, you know, be watching them disobey the law of the land? So it starts from the head. Everything rises and falls with leadership. You know, I thought we have gotten a good leadership in 2015, but unfortunately, they are the same. There is no difference between the previous government and this government. They always, you know, pontificate, you know, deceive people, you know, propaganda and lies. And at the end, you see it, you know, fall flat on your face. This is not the best time for Nigeria. Doctors are on strike. Now judicial staff are on strike. I also understand that even the parliamentary staff, the parliamentarians also, because they also were given autonomy. Yeah, they are also, I don't know whether they have resumed. Then the local government you mentioned now, local government autonomy was celebrated with so much from, I mean, the issue of financial disenabled that time approved by the NFIU said, you know, and there was so much praise and commendation for the government. But as I speak to you today, the local government are still in the worst state, you know, in the worst position. My state that even purportedly conducted a local government election, that is, instead the same thing. They'll give, maybe you are entitled to 100 million naira, you know, by way of monthly allocation. The state governments will dip hands into that money and then give maybe local government chairman 4 million for their own pocket, then take the rest and then give them small money to go and pay salaries. And then the entire other money, they mess up. And that's how all the governors have been impeding progress in Nigeria. That's how Nigerians have been, we are retarded. We're not making any progress. And I thought that the federal government of Nigeria, that meant change for Nigeria, will change all that nonsense that is going on. That local government should have their money directly. And then they should use it to develop local government all over the country. But today, as I speak to you, governors are still meddling with the funds of local government. Governors are still meddling with the judicial autonomy. Governors are still meddling with parliamentary autonomy in all their state centers of assembly autonomy. They're still meddling with it. And the government is standing idly and be watching them do all that, you know, including the government, federal government themselves also, that do not obey their own laws and all that. So it's a question of lawlessness all over the country, and it's unfortunate. And the only language you understand is strike. And so I am not surprised that these people are eventually going to strike, even though people are pleading with them to go back and all that. But I think that this time around, they should insist that this full autonomy should be granted to the arm of government, you know. That's the way to move this country forward, by way of strike, you know. They don't listen to any other language. They don't listen to language of peace. They only listen to the language of force.
Mr. Obani, those who may not really get where, you know, these judiciary workers are coming from regarding judicial autonomy, I want you to help us explain this, you know. How would this judicial autonomy help in the dispensation of justice without fear or favor?
It's a very good question, an intelligent question. You know, he who pays the piper actually detects the tune. We've been, you know, battling with this issue of autonomy for the other arms of government. If you understand how democracy operates, press on three-part, there are the executive, the legislature, and the judiciary. They are the three arms of government that combine all to give effective governance to the people. Now, they are supposed to operate independently, but at the same time, conjunctively, in order to give people good governance. Now, if one arm of government is one clearly now in charge of their finances, they will not allow the other arms of government to determine certain things, because they are the one holding the purse. And when they're holding your pulse, they will not allow you to independently take a decision, especially when that decision will be contrary to their whims and caprices. You see the danger? That's why you see most state courts, you know, all the state high courts, most time, if there's any matter between you and the state government in the court that is manned by the officials of the state government, they will most time give judgment in favor of the state government. They are not bold enough to give judgment where justice demands. And so that is the danger of issue of lack of financial autonomy. The governors, what they would do most time, and of course they do it with so much fanfare, is that they build houses for governors and then share those houses as if they are sharing their personal houses, they built with their money. Sometimes they buy all these luxurious cars, jeeps, and then begin to share, and they call the press to the judges as if they are also sharing their personal cars they bought with their money, whereas this money supposed to have been given to the judiciary independently. So they will determine what they want to use the money for, especially developing the basic infrastructures that are necessary for easier dispensation of justice. We are not having structures on ground. Some of them don't have, courtrooms. Some of them don't have computers. Some of them don't have the modern gadgets with which that makes administration of justice, to be quicker and easier.
All right. But
these governors take over and begin to do as if they are giving their own personal money, not allowing that first line charge as recommended by the Constitution, that this money should go to them, to the heads of the court, who will now determine what they will use the money to do. But the governors are the ones now determining when to give them money, when to release money, and when not to release money.
Well,
so it does affect
also
the independence of other arms of government.
Mr. Abani, there's also, of course, the part where judges, will still collect these SUVs and these houses, like you've mentioned. It's also possible that they reject these things, but we don't see that happening. I now want to bring your views in on the role of the Nigerian Bar Association. Olumide Akpata, the current president, has said that he does support the idea of a strike, but the timing is wrong. According to him, he says he believes in the battle for financial autonomy of the judiciary, but the timing of the planned strike would spell doom for the country, considering the negative impact of the COVID-19 pandemic in the last 1 year. Do you agree with his thoughts that maybe the timing of this strike is not right?
Yes, the position of MPA president is a very sensitive position, and then the government will not want him to take a hardline position that they may not like by wholeheartedly saying, "Oh, go ahead, we are all for independence of the judiciary," and then continue with the strike. He has to balance his speech so that he will not be regarded as supporting what he's playing now. That's why he now tells you timing. But you ask yourself, what time is actually right for you to go on strike? What time is actually right for you to demand this independence of judiciary that has always been there since 1999 in the Constitution? And then you sign an executive order last year in which you now say, look, enough of all this. I want to start implementing independence of these two other two arms. And then all of a sudden, you prevaricated. You soft pedal and allow the governor's interest to supersede that of the people. So to me, the president of the NBA is trying to sound politically correct, and he's being careful not to, as if he's giving room for support of what is playing out recently with this strike. Lawyers are suffering. Many lawyers depend on going to court. And then the economy at this point in time is very fragile. If you now insist on a full strike, you don't know how long that strike will last. And lawyers will be without money for as many months as possible. That, again, will begin to have negative impact on the economy, have negative impact on the purse of the lawyers. So he is trying to be very careful not to say, oh, I totally support the whole strike, let it continue. He's trying, oh, I plead with you. I agree with you in whatever you are demanding, but can you also reconsider the timing now and then, probably suspend the strike, pending the time you continue the negotiation with the government over this? That's what I understand him to be saying. But I tell you that many other people may not want that, especially the staffers. They will want this particular issue to be determined once and for all. Let's actually insist on independence of the judiciary. There is no reason for sub-pedaling on it. There's no reason, because it's affecting administration of justice generally. Administration of justice is the one suffering when we cannot guarantee independence of the judiciary. People are not getting justice. You see what happened during the N-Style protest, where the courts became even a target. People burned the courts. And we're ready even to attack, lawyers and even judges, because they're feeling that they're not getting justice. They're not getting what they expect as people, from that particular arm of government. So I think that it is high time we all come together collectively and insist that the right thing be done. The governors must give the judiciary the necessary autonomy that it requires.
All right. Before we go on a short break, I wanted to ask you about something you mentioned earlier. You mentioned double standards, that, you know, the government had agreed, or the president, he had signed this executive order, he had agreed. You know, you even made reference to other strikes, like the strike with the doctors, the one with the university lecturers and polytechnic lecturers. And you said it's about double standards, you know, that the government seemed to agree with the workers, but then, you know, they breached those contracts. But do you think, really, the double standards is the issue here when it comes to implementing, you know, agreements that the government and the people decide?
I think that is an aim of, by the other arm of government, to suppress the judiciary. And so that's why that lack of interest, you know, of zeal to implement any agreement that is reached on the side. There is this intention that the moment they keep the judicial under their wraps, you know, they can do whatever they want to do with Nigerians and get away with it. But I tell you this, a lot of problems in this country would have been solved if we get our judiciary right, you know. Dispensation of justice is key. Where people commit all manner of corrupt cases and then the goods cost free, it affects the economy the more. Where people commit all manner of criminalities and when they are being charged to court, we discover that the administration of criminal justice is very weak and not dispensing so quickly, and in a manner that people will have confidence. It affects Nigerians, it affects Nigeria, and everything, politically, economically. So there are people who are benefiting from a weak judiciary. They are happy that that arm of government is very weak. They can suppress it, they can kill it, they can do whatever they want to do and get away with it because they know that the judicial arm is very weak. So that is why you see the ambivalence. That's why you see the deception. That's why they have not run to engage them. Even when they were threatening that they're going to go on strike, nobody was ready to engage them at all. So it is a double standard. It's a double standard that is motivated. It's ill-motivated. It is made out of a fact that they want to hold that arm of government, you know, in a weak position. And as long as they remain, that particular arm remains, they will get away with whatever they want to do with the country, you know. And then they are very happy.
Manu Bani, we would like you to hold on. We are being joined by the National Treasurer of the Judicial Staff Union of Nigeria, Jusun Jimoh Musa, is going to be joining us. So please just hold on. We'll connect with him right after this short break. And, you know, of course, we both can have this conversation.